Ladies and gentlemen, this is The Shift Happens, B-Sides and Rarities Edition. It's been a while since we've done one of these, but we are going to be doing these every single Saturday from now on. And tonight, joining us as per usual is our co-host JP. What's happening, JP?
Hey, man. What's going on? I'm so glad to do a B-Side. It's been a while, so looking forward to it. It's a nice, incredible Saturday in Los Angeles. The weather is radical. Outside all day. It's nice.
Hell yeah. Yep, the weather is incredibly shitty here in Houston.
It's over 100 degrees there, right?
Shit, I didn't even go outside during the day. I just waited till night. I just didn't even want to fuck with it. But but yeah, so we're here tonight. Joining us is Jeff Renel from eTalk TV, Ryan Burns from Spacewolf Research, and Erik Awakening Man, and they are going to be discussing their, we're at least going to start off discussing their latest research trip out there to Spacewolf and SkinWalker, essentially. So yeah, welcome, fellas. How's it going?
It's going great, man. Thanks for having us on.
Yeah, definitely. And
A lot went on. I don't know if we're going to, probably not going to tell you guys everything, but I'll try to manipulate as much of the information out there that's been approved.
We need it all, Erik.
We got a special agreement with Ryan, so we got to respect that agreement, but we'll try to say as much as we can within reason.
Fair enough.
We'll make it spicy.
Right on. So when was this exactly?
This was very recent. Oh,
okay. 2 weeks ago.
Okay. Right on. And I watched that video that Erik put together with some proper editing and music in the background, some still frames, and pretty good little production of some of the highlights of the trip. And I don't know if you saw that video, Ryan, but at the end of the video, they show a couple guys doing this little ceremony. They had this, like, you know, weird cup that looked like a cup made out of stone or something, and they poured some liquid in there, and they both took some sips of it. What was that exactly? What was that ritual, and what was that liquid?
The liquid is part of, we incorporated a bunch of traditional ritualistic modalities to kind of go along with the experiments that were taking place. So just to kind of break it all down, there was a number of things going on. An Angelaf was present, also a Pandora star. Those are basically light technologies that mimic the DMT experience, and they were being used alongside some audio gateway technology and some other resonance instruments, as well as just some deep trance meditational stuff taking place. So there was a lot taking place, and that ending was just kind of the culmination of it all. The combination of the light technologies and the audio kind of, Jeff can tell you a little bit about that, but it really opened up the space as far as, you know, that third eye, the pineal gland, if it's not calcified, that enhances the ability to basically have an experience that is more astral than your day-to-day experience. And at the end, that was just kind of the culmination of the whole thing. What we weren't expecting was the onset of what seemed to be an observer of some sort in the skies above us. And yeah, that was that was a very interesting part of it.
Yeah, it looked very up my alley. Yeah. Absolutely. And right on. So hey, what's up, Dragon Bros in the chat? Good to see you. And it was kind of a go ahead.
Can I ask a question here? Because I'm looking at the picture that Erik had posted on Twitter. And so that is us with some type of craft or something in the sky. Was that same night?
Yeah, you didn't get the video, did you? I put it to you on Twitter. Did you ever watch the video?
No, I watched the video, but I didn't see or notice that. I mean, I was looking at this picture earlier today and was like, oh, that's cool, but I didn't put two and two together. So that occurred that same night then, huh?
Yeah, that was after midnight. I'm pretty sure it was around midnight or maybe a little before or after, but I didn't see it. This was just me out there with the cell phone taking a picture of you guys down there by the campfire or whatever and did not see it. And then I put it in the night mode on my Samsung Galaxy S21. And so when you do that, you got to hold it still for about 4 or 5 seconds. You know, it opens up and then it clicks the picture. And then, of course, it looks like it's daytime, a distorted view, version of daytime. But then when I looked at the picture, then I saw that red thing there. Looks like it has some sort of, moving object shape to it. It wasn't just a ball of light. It was, I've never seen anything quite like that. It was weird. But yeah, it was there. You can't hoax that, right? At least I can't.
And that's an amazing camera. You really kind of I can't believe how well that thing can, aperture wise, can just suck in the light. Like the pictures of the moon that night, as well as some other things, I've been really impressed with the zoom and everything else on that camera. And but yeah, it was pretty crazy. Jeff, what were your thoughts of that evening?
You know, it was a lot of fun. I loved hanging out with everybody. My experience on the Angela, I can never say that, the raised lamp was absolutely amazing. I actually cannot wait to do it again, to go a little bit deeper into there and just kind of understand what I saw, because my experience under the lights kind of feel like a dream almost right at this moment and stuff. So I really want to go back under, but it was really, really a fun night. It was great hanging out with everybody, and the ceremony at the end, it was a lot of fun, and I still don't know how I feel about that.
It did get pretty wild, man. And yeah, GG, to just kind of clarify, it did get pretty wild as far as everything taking place. Like, everything functioned as it should, and some of the resonance instruments were actually designed to, like, speak to or draw in marine life, and it almost sounded like whale calls in the night. So you can imagine, like, on a full moon, just south of the old Bigelow Ranch, with all this mayhem taking place, but of course controlled chaos, you know, out of chaos, or out of order the chaos. So it's like the culmination of it at the end was really interesting. There was like reciting of poems by Catholic saints, very interesting beverages that were being drank, and as I think you mentioned, being drank out of receptacles that are not commonplace in day-to-day activities. So it was definitely pretty wild.
Yeah. Like I said, right up my alley. Yeah.
Yeah. I'm glad I didn't miss it. That's for sure. I'm glad I was there. And, you know, things you can only experience there, I would say.
And so it looked like you got... Oh, go ahead.
I was just going to say, it goes to show that a lot of the... And I would share more, but it goes to show that a lot of the things that work are not always... You know, it's like you're just throwing stuff at the wall and seeing what sticks. And so you're basically coming out with everything, right? Like the arsenal of oddities, a bunch of esoteric and very ritualistic things that, you know, in and of themselves could probably do what, you know, what we were after, but just the variety and all of the things going on at once just kind of seemed to exponentially change the energy. And yeah, the culmination at the end, I mean, it was wild, man.
Could you
Ryan, I want to go ahead, JP. Go ahead.
Yeah, can you tell us like the equipment that y'all had, and like do any of you have a full spectrum camera and all that?
Yeah, there was a lot of equipment on site. Everything from these instruments to very esoteric items, ancient books, bones of animals, bones of humans, a human skull, very interesting beverages. As I said, like a lot of instrumentation, sound, audio, gateway is what they call them, technologies to kind of take the person that is under the light or under the lamp there. And these lamps are very interesting because these technologies are said to have been created, or more so channeled, by their creators, one of which was a Catholic priest. That was the Anja lamp, which utilizes five lights that kind of pulse in different orders and mimic this DMT experience to a degree. And the other one is the Pandora star. And, you know, the Anja lamp, its creator believed that it was channeled by way of angels. The Pandora star utilizes 12 lights. I believe the guy name was Gary who created that. And he believed that he was channeling this and that it was ET extraterrestrial technology. But, I mean, I think it's really all semantics, you know, angels or ETs or whatever, what have you. But the reality is that these technologies do offer a way to kind of mimic that and open up this gateway along with the audio and other modalities where you can kind of pierce the veil, or at least have experiences that are more astral in nature, or kind of peek behind the veil and see what's going on.
Hey, can I ask a question really quick to you, Ryan, then? So you're saying there was two different lamps there. There was the Anja lamp, and then there was another one that had the star in it. Is that what you're saying?
Yeah, the Pandora star. That's right.
So that's the one that I went under then at the end, because I remember looking up at it and seeing the star on it and seeing it was different than the Anja lamp that I've used with Ray before. And it was a way different experience. It was way more intense.
And I think that last time, I mean, energy was high, and I think you went under for a full like 44 minutes, if I'm not mistaken. You were like Neo in the Matrix. You went way in there.
Yeah, I need to do it again because it was so interesting. I mean, at first, I think I was telling you guys I was fighting it. I mean, it instantly made me just sucked into the experience, and I had to start to calm myself down because my heart rate started to go up, my breathing changed, my breathing was erratic, I was shaking, my legs were shaking really bad. And so I had to start calming myself down. I mean, really, mentally, I felt like I had taken too much acid or too much mushrooms, and I was starting to have a bad trip. I mean, I almost wanted to put my hands over my eyes and stop it at first, but I just kept telling myself, this is just lights, this is just lights. And once I started to calm down, then that's when I really was sucked into the experience even more. And I mean, I'm not sure if I fell asleep or if it just sucked me in so much that the time went by so fast, because before I knew it, it was over with. And I know I was telling you guys the next day at breakfast that I was having these amazing images that I just don't know where they came from. If they're, you know, conscious thoughts of myself that were creating these images, if it was images that were help induced by the experience I was having from the lights, I just don't know, but it was absolutely amazing. And again, I just can't wait to go try it again. just to be able to start to dissect it and see, is my experience going to be different? And you know, how did that work? Because like I said, it kind of feels like a dream now.
So do you keep your eyes open when you're under that thing, or do you close them?
You close your eyes.
Okay. Yeah, I'd imagine that'd be pretty blinding if you...
Yeah, and you know, what was amazing is, like I said, as soon as the lights came on, I mean, you're right into the experience. It just sucks you right in. You know, there's no, you know, feeling it come on, anything like that. It's just, boom, you're in it. And at first, I could hear the people talking around me because, you know, we had several people out there, probably 10 people, I think. And I could hear the people talking, but that quickly went away, and I was just sucked right into that experience and didn't hear a sound from anybody else all the rest of the way through that whole experience.
And keep in mind that this is a place where, even without any of this stuff, if you're just there, there is a likelihood of wild things taking place. So when you kind of show up on site with this arsenal of equipment that works in symphony together, it creates kind of this exponential energy experience. And I can only imagine that it makes it more probable and more likely, as well as possible, for this contact with what I believe is a precognitive sentient intelligence, which is what the Pentagon and Department of Defense named it through Colonel John Alexander. But yeah, there seems to be this entity, this phenomenon, this intelligence in the area that not only knows what you're going to do, so it's precognitive in nature, but it manifests in ways that you don't expect. So I can only imagine that having all these things together kind of from a consciousness aspect just is very enticing, kind of like bait on a hook. And it doesn't surprise me at all that Erik caught an image of something that very much seemed to be observing at least the direction of the way it seemed to be facing, if the red light is any truth to where it was looking, that it seemed to be observing or watching or at least navigating its way around us or above us.
I want to ask, Ryan, I'm assuming you showed this to Ray, what his feedback was. And the other thing is, after we get done talking about that, we could talk about what those other guys from Colorado saw the night before, because that, you heard that conversation. That was pretty interesting too.
Super huge, yes. And very good questions. Oh my gosh, Erik. So Ray is very much of the belief, he's kind of anti-camera, anti-technology for the most part, unless it's these consciousness technologies we're talking about in unison with some of these other modalities like the audio gateways, etc. And he was very much, you know, anti the trying to capture things on camera. However, when I showed him the image, it really resonated with him because he kind of, you know, was like, oh my gosh, there really is something to this. Yeah, you feel it. You feel its presence, but to be able to catch a glimpse of it is something else. And he and I are both very much of the belief that these are intelligences that display themselves. It's not a matter of, oh, we caught it on camera, or we hunted for it and we got it. You know, it's something that if it does not want to be seen, it will not be seen. So he and I are very much of the same belief that it displays itself to observers, and that is just kind of a treat to be able to even see any inkling of what it might be manifesting as from a visual perspective. And as far as what those guys saw the night before, they were up on the mesa, looking to the south, which was directly in the direction of Spacewolf Research, and they saw a very large triangular craft hovering directly, is what they said, over Spacewolf Research. Interestingly, we also saw something that night, the ones that were there, that was in that same location, very low to the ground, almost unbelievably low to the ground. At times, we thought that it was above us, but we didn't see it. But it did show lights as well. And when we would see the lights, they were just hovering. So I think those guys got a really good view of something again that we were, I was so mixed up in doing what I was doing that sometimes you fail to pay attention of what might be directly over your head observing you.
Yeah, going back to the guys that, another thing that they mentioned, this was very interesting to me, was he said that he saw the triangle through the night vision, I believe he had, or I believe that's what he was talking about. And then it was no lights were on. This was just a black triangle with no lights. Then it went into the clouds, and then he was able to film it at that point. But he couldn't actually see it in the clouds, but he said the clouds were like sparkling and kind of like almost like there was electricity in the clouds. You remember that part of it?
I actually didn't have that conversation that you had with him. I was talking to the other guy from the other ranch, but I'll tell you what, it's exactly what I noticed. So that's really good that there's some verification there. So it definitely helps to have other people witness something and then tell you about it, even if it's the next day, because it makes the reality of what's taking place that much more real. It's so easy to get caught up in your own head in some of these locations just due to the energies. There's spikes in electromagnetic frequencies as well as other geologic anomalies which take place. As you guys know, I mean, really wild stuff. Things will get moved around. Doesn't matter how big or how small they are. This intelligence is able to manipulate material and things in ways that are absolutely paranormal, absolutely supernatural, and I mean, quite literally demigod status.
Yeah, and
go ahead, Gigi.
No, you go ahead.
I was going to say the times that I've been out there and what I've filmed from Vernal, I'm going to guess that triangle had to be less than 5 miles as the crow flies from where your place is. But nothing, I know you have, but nothing of the skinwalker nature, more of, like you just said, the paranormal, the strange lights. The other thing those guys mentioned that after, I believe it was after they had seen the triangle, a short period after that, there were some greenish blue lights that were about the size of a beach ball, I believe he said. I think he said four or five of them that were moving around in the trees down there. Now, your property is kind of elevated. It's actually, in my opinion, I would rather have your property than the Walker property, because you could see the trees, you could see the Indian land down there, you could literally see the Walker property, you could see everything. So it's a much better view. But anyway, where these guys were, they could see these things moving around in the trees, couldn't really, you know, get a really good look at it, but they knew something was happening. The guy said that he watched this. They all watched it. There was like three or four of them watched it for like 30 minutes. And then they decided to get in the car and drive up the road, which I'm guessing would be the equivalent of about maybe two or three or four blocks, let's say. And when they got in the car and drove up the road, then whatever those lights were, they were gone.
Yeah, and that happens often. Whenever you pursue the phenomenon, it oftentimes, you know, again, it's almost as if it displays itself to the observer. However, the reason why is still unclear. It does it for a reason, but I mean, we're all just human, and it's very difficult to perceive what reason it would have for these flamboyant light shows and other depictions that it basically manifests as. It just kind of has it will manifest itself in ways that just absolutely amaze the observer, and then disappear so quickly and just, you know, into the deep of nothingness that it just leaves you reeling like, whoa, did I really see that? And other nights it'll creep up and the manifestations will start small and then kind of level up into a crescendo of stuff. So it's just wild. The area, something allows whatever is doing this to do so with ease compared to other places I've gone where they're also hotspots, but it's just the ease with which this phenomena can manifest itself is fascinating to me. And, you know, it's interesting that, sorry to go off a little tangent, it's interesting that you mentioned these other guys from this other ranch, because I think when you guys showed up, they were just approaching me and interested in purchasing it. And this keeps happening. I've actually had it happen since that time when we recently met up. And I keep getting these, you know, these offers you can't refuse. And people will see something, and I get it. You know, it's super tantalizing, and it's like, wow, and you know, you gotta sell to me. But, you know, these offers keep coming in, and it just, in reality, a lot of this land, Gigi, for lack of a better word, it does not lend itself well to humans. You see it in the daytime, and I often say, like, in the daytime, it's very unappealing. But once that sun goes down, and it seems like more entitlement takes place with whatever this precognitive sentient intelligence is, it really has a heyday. Once the lights go down, the magic happens.
Yeah. Yeah, I bet so. And and you know, I'm pretty positive I've brought this idea to you before, last time you were on the show. You know, I was, you know, I was watching the SkinWalker Ranch documentary that Jeremy Corbell did quite a few years ago, and you know, think what you will about Jeremy Corbell, but there's another guy that was on there who was one of the scientists at NIDS, back when NIDS owned SkinWalker for like what, 20 years, and we're doing research there, and he said once he said this statement, like, I got like it wasn't even my thought, it was like almost like a download, like this thought just popped into my head of this idea. And so he said something along the lines of, you know, out of the 20 years, you know, we ran these experiments trying to figure out what was causing all this phenomenon and the trickery type stuff and just all the stuff that happens over there at SkinWalker Ranch. They said they were not able to make any connection between the UFOs and the phenomenon. And then this idea just popped into my head. Like I said, I didn't think this up. Like I was just delivered this idea from somewhere. And the idea is that, you know, that possibly the UFOs are there to study the phenomena themselves, just like, you know, you guys go there to study it. They're trying to figure out what's going on there too, and that there's some intelligence that's, you know, perhaps related to Gaia or something else, and they're trying to figure out what that is too, rather than them being the ones causing the phenomenon. Have you ever heard anybody else say that idea, or what do you think about that?
100%, man. And interestingly, Ray and I met through Jeremy Corbell, but I won't go down that rabbit hole. The interesting thing about that, what you just said, is there have been cases where scientists have been looking at a portal manifesting. There is virtually these vortexes that can, for lack of a better word, open up like energy zones, and you can tell it's going to go down. And you can sense that an anomaly is going to take place. And when this was happening, these scientists were watching this, and one of them looked over and saw literally an alien gray, not looking at them, but looking at this portal manifesting. And oftentimes these portals will manifest like a small singular speck of light and then slowly grow and manifest, get larger and larger to where they seem to be forming gateways for things to move in and out of, much like a wormhole. And then they will de-manifest and go back into nothingness. this guy, who was a very nuts and bolts guy, and all kinds of security clearances, saw basically an alien gray looking at the portal, and he could care less about the scientists. He was just there for the show. So I think you're right on, GG, 100%.
Wow, yeah. I didn't know anybody else thought of that. Yeah, that's cool. And I think that might be the case, honestly. And just like when that thought popped into my head, you know, like I said, it didn't come from me. It came from somewhere else. It just instantly, like, I got the goosebumps. And it was like a big, like, moment. Like, whoa. Like, you know?
And, you know, something else that happens there, and Jeff is very familiar with this. I won't tell you the objects that we were finding on the ground because it's a sensitive nature, but you'll find objects on the ground that should present themselves very easily to you. You know, they should catch your eye. And once you start finding these objects, you know, which just finding one of them would be like a mind-blowing situation, you'll find like a bunch more of them, like in close proximity. And I've had multiple people, literally droves of people who I know, go back and forth over these same spots, and they show up at the same spots, and you'll be picking them up, and you're thinking, okay, there's no way there can be any left. So many people have scoured this area looking for these particular things. There's no way that there can be any left. And you'll find more. You'll find so many sometimes that it's almost as if they're replenishing, which again is impossible, or being gifted. And this brings us to kind of this this top secret national security aspect of this. There seems to be something taking place in the area that they termed bidirectional mimicry, which means whatever you're bringing to the table can be exponentially overblown and utilized by this precognitive sentient intelligence as a form of communication. It's like a trickster. It's just trying to talk with you in whatever way in this material form that we as human beings call reality. It's just trying to find any way to kind of communicate or have an interaction with us, which is really a beautiful thing. But whatever you bring to the table, whether that's interest or actual technology, or even in the case of other experiments, more dangerous stuff, it will bring something much 10 times, 100 times more powerful than what you bring to the table to interact with you. And that's kind of what it reminds me of. Like, we placed, for example, that night we had things like Rubik's cubes on hand, things that you would think a child would want to play with. These are all things that this precognitive and sentient intelligence loves to interact with. In fact, back during the Bigelow regime, before it was just a popular TV show, when it was actually a black budget Pentagon project, he would utilize aquariums filled with children's toys at the top of telephone poles, you know, something where nothing could get to it, but they would place these things in these indescribably hard to get to spots to see if this trickster phenomenon or intelligence could actually just, you know, with ease go in and play with these things because it found them interesting. And it happened time and time again. They used all kinds of esoteric means, Ouija boards that were made specifically for that area. And, you know, we're finding that he was, with good reason, most involved with and drawn to the consciousness aspect and the esoteric aspects, because that's where the most bang for the buck was taking place. It wasn't in these other areas. And, yeah, man, I'm just, you know, why reinvent the wheel when this guy spent millions and millions of dollars of his own money, as well as $22 million of taxpayer dollars, trying to investigate this very phenomenon? You know, who am I to try to reinvent the wheel? I'm going to go with the consciousness aspect. I'm going to go with what's proven, which is if you're going to play with a trickster, you kind of have to be ready to do some tricks.
Yeah, I bet.
And you know, it was funny because Ryan was showing me that, what he was talking about just a minute ago, and he was showing me how to find these things, and I couldn't find a single one. And he just kept going, oh, here's one, here's one, here's one, here's one, here's one, here's one. And I'm just like, get out of here. And I'm looking, and I can't find a single one. And he just keeps picking them right up off the ground. I was just like, dude, you're just playing with me now. And it was absolutely hilarious.
And it's not me. It's like once your mind is open to believing something is there, it's there. And this sounds super crazy, but there's so many examples of this. I've had caretakers in the past interact with things with, I mean, it's almost as if the last thing you want to say is, did you hear that? You know what I mean? It's like, don't even go there, because the minute you start to play ball, it's game on. And I've had unique experiences where, for example, I'll be staying in the base camp towards the back of the property in this little cabin, and you'll hear things outside. And when we rebuilt the cabin, it was vaporized along with a 40-foot RV in the middle of the day, one day. And this seems to be an area that it's trying to keep part of the area clear for whatever reason. And actually, it's right where Jeff and I were finding these things. But in this particular spot, I had a 40-foot steel container placed in the same location as the 40-foot RV to see if I could get another example of, you know, this interaction. And, you know, it was far-fetched. I didn't think it would happen. I thought, well, you know, this is 100% steel. It should get hit by lightning, where an RV is insulated and shouldn't. And I mean, the RV was vaporized. There was nothing left but molten metal and glass. And so I put a 40-foot steel container there. It was useful because we could put technology and other stuff inside of it, kind of for safekeeping. And, you know, the last thing I would have ever expected took place. It was never hit by lightning, which makes zero sense. It's not grounded. It's literally just waiting to get zapped. But what did happen is it literally got moved from that spot and turned from, it was in an east-west direction, and it got turned, lifted, and turned to a north-south direction without so much as disturbing a blade of grass. Like, literally, this thing just got picked up and turned. And I haven't put anything back in that spot now. It's like, literally, I understand, you know, this is meant to stay the way it is. And whenever I stay back there at the cabin, and a lot of the other guys have had these experiences too, as soon as you hear something or you get up to check on something, that's when things get weird. If you hear it and you don't do anything, you can kind of control our reality a little bit. But there's something about, whether you want to call it the shapeshifter, the skinwalker entity, this intelligence can roam this area with like complete abandon. It's the one in charge there. It's home. It's not our home. We're playing in its playground.
Yeah, I want to agree with that, because last summer when I was there by myself, I had that happen to me. I was there by the fire, and I kept hearing this little jingling noise behind me to my left. And at first I was just ignoring it. And I want to say that whole night I was totally on edge. I just didn't feel right that whole night there by myself. And I could hear this little jingling noise, and I just was ignoring it at first. And then eventually I'm like, well, I got to look to see what it is. So I turned behind me to my left, and I'm looking, and that's basically where that storage shed is. And I'm looking, and there's nothing there. There's nothing to be making this little jingling noise that I hear. And so as I'm observing and looking over in that direction, I hear the noise again. But the noise is coming again from behind me to my left. And so now I turn again to look to that direction, and I'm looking to see what could be making the noise, and there's nothing there. And I hear the noise again, and again, that noise is behind me to my left. So I turn again to look, and there's still nothing there. And it basically made me do almost a 360 trying to find where this noise was coming from. And I still don't know where it was coming from, but it obviously was moving around behind me. And so it was a very interesting night that night.
You know, it's really strange because I think some of the things that have taken place with other researchers who have gone there, and one, you can never kind of limit what takes place. And what I mean by that is I had one very adept ghost hunter and his crew go up there, and he was a little bit worried about safety and things like that. So he brought along a guy for security who had a weapon. And, you know, what he recorded was something that has since haunted me, because I still wonder, is it very, it's very real on the recording, but, you know, was it the phenomenon or was it a real event? And long story short, they were they got all kinds of very interesting EVPs and ghost hunting type activity. Lots of strange phenomena took place. But then there was a hail of bullets. And I mean, like, they were under attack. It was like a wartime scenario. And they literally had to hide behind the steel container for protection. And they said they could hear the bullets whizzing by. It sounded quite literally like security or the police force or like just a bunch of guys were firing upon them for no apparent reason, which is hard to believe, right? But I'm listening to the bullets. I'm seeing this taking place in real time. I'm talking to him on the phone at 1 a.m. and, you know, I'm hearing it over the phone and I keep thinking to myself, is it the trickster interacting or is it a real scenario? And either way, I mean, it's mind-boggling. And it's just an example of, you know, what happens when you take things in, you get things out. Oh, I think I might have lost you guys. Did I lose you?
No, I'll jump in. So what I wanted to ask you, by the way, that episode that you just talked about, I've listened to so many radio shows over the years. That was one of the more impactful shows. I mean, just you could feel that these guys were not BSing, as far as I could tell. What they were talking about, it really went down, and it was pretty freaky stuff. I mean, I'll tell you what, if I had been out there with those guys and all that was going down, I would have been pretty excited. I would have been, I don't know if I'd have been nervous, but I certainly would have been excited, you know?
Yeah, it was, 100%. I mean, there's no way that they were lying about it. They had a lot of things happen, and this happens all the time. I mean, they had a lot of expensive gear with them in the back of the truck. They just threw it in the back of the truck and started driving back. And they had missing time too, which was really strange. And I mean, this gear is stuff that they would usually, you know, put under various tarps and keep covered. It started raining and they did nothing of the sort. You know, they just let it rain on all this expensive gear, which is not like them. And they were all in kind of a daze. And this has happened time and time again. No matter how prepared the people going in are, and there's plenty of examples of ex-military, you name it, people that are extremely intelligent, security guards, actually private security as well. And you literally, after having interactions with this phenomenon, you kind of get it handed to you in whatever way seems most appropriate by this intelligence. And the more you get to know that, the more you get to interact with this intelligence, the more I call it, it's kind of a dance. The more of a dance takes place instead of just like these harsh, brutal, rough moves, it turns into kind of a symphony of strangeness. And I mean, I prefer that, but at the same time, it's just wild what can make this interaction take place. There's been many times that, like what Jeff was saying, I've had these strange lights come around corners and shine much like a flashlight. And you're sure there's somebody behind the corner holding a flashlight, and you'll go around the corner and there's nothing there. And it will be around the next corner of the structure, and you'll go around that corner and there's nothing there. And in one super dramatic case, I literally had something coming from a 0 point area. Like, there was nothing there. Literally a beam shined down around a corner, and I was in the middle of this like spotlight, and the person I was with was horrified. I mean, it looked like something out of an abduction scenario, and I was super calm because I'm like, oh, it's just playing. And so for an outsider, that can be seen as something very, very tragic and scary. But once you get used to it, you know, it's not as traumatic.
Yeah, I think I would just be purely excited, you know. I don't think I'd really be scared of it. Yeah, I'm just more curious.
But, yeah, and there's a lot of curious things happen in the area as well. There are, obviously there is the Native American aspect of all this, which again brings in a lot of ritual and esotericism, and a lot of it is very occult. And I mean, there were wild curses being thrown around this area from Native American tribe to Native American tribe, from the Navajo to the Ute, as well as wild curses occurring from the Buffalo soldiers there in Fort Duchesne, who were all Prince Hall Masons, most of which also practiced or knew about voodoo from the Caribbean. So we had all kinds of esotericism that has been present in this area for quite some time, and 15 generations, according to the native peoples in the area, that high strangeness has taken place. Mm-hmm. Now, that doesn't mean that, you know, that doesn't mean, don't get me wrong, that doesn't mean that I believe any TV show can show up and have wild stuff happen every episode. But at the same time, the formula is there. You know, all the ingredients are there. There is all kinds of geologic anomalies, and it has kind of become a breeding ground of television shows, paranormal ranches, a lot of interest in this, and I'm all good with that. I think the more people that are funding research out of their own pockets, the better. However, given the fact that there's all these anomalies taking place at the same time, it becomes kind of a metaphysical Disneyland. We have a massive power line feature that goes along this Red Rock Mesa in the area, and the electromagnetic frequencies coming off this thing are insane. It has cracked casings, and you can hear them chattering. There's so much power going through these lines. As well as the sandstone mesa that I'm talking about, there is a man-made body of water there who has its own deep, dark history of all kinds of strange happenings taking place there. And this water has a tendency to seep through this very porous sandstone under this electromagnetic frequency caused by the overhead power lines. And then you have all the esoteric, the occult practices in the area, the shapeshifters that have been seen, things that, for lack of a better word, are cryptozoological in nature, portals manifesting out of nowhere. And whenever you get just a hint of water or storminess in the area, the energy levels just skyrocket. I mean, your gear will take readings, even on a bright sunny day, your gear will take readings of things that should not have any magnetism to them. Things made of plastic, things made of, and then it'll go from a super high, possibly dangerous reading down to zero. And this is super strange. It's so strange that I buy multiple devices to check these measurements. And it doesn't matter how many devices you have, you'll get spikes in electromagnetic frequency, spikes in all kinds of readings that will very transiently disappear, leaving you just scratching your head like, how is this possible? And getting back to that super huge 40-foot steel container that I put in the place of the 40-foot RV that got vaporized in the middle of the day, that container, after it was moved by what seemed like non-human humanly possible means by everyone who investigated it, that container was magnetized. And those levels have gone up and down, almost non-existent, and then sometimes creep back. It was so magnetized that you could take anything that was made of metal and it would stick to it. Even some of the rocks in the area would stick to this storage container. So it's just weird. I mean, we're talking about real, raw, powerful energy. And I like that you said Gaia, GG, earlier, because that's the only way to explain some of it.
Yeah. And yeah, that resonates with me. And yeah, that's really fascinating, you know. And I've, you know, we talked before on the show about exactly why, you know, all the different clues and markings in both the ground and the container that you should see from it being moved by conventional means, none of that was there. And yeah, that's a real I mean, that's just incredible.
And things like that will happen all the time. I think just the raw size of that is what really fascinated me, but little things get moved all the time. Little things will be left all the time, gifted or taken away, which is very, very trickster-ish, right? Like phones will go missing that should not go missing. Items, it'll jumble your head, which sounds super crazy. You can be 100% on your game, and if you're there long enough, it'll get to the point where you're just like, what the hell? Like, you don't even know what time it is. You don't know what you have in your pockets. You don't know what you left in your car. It will jumble you in a way, if you're open to it sometimes, that just leaves you confounded. And I've caught researchers jokingly, they, you know, they'll call me and say, hey, you've probably seen me walking around in circles for hours. And it's like, no, man, I totally understand. Like, it's not your fault. You know, I get it. I've done the same thing myself. And it'll do that to you. It will change your emotions, your feelings, your reaction times. And basically, you just won't know up from down, left from right. And you'll just get very confused without any real reason for it.
Man, that just makes me want to go there so much more. And I really want to experience that. And yeah, I mean, I even heard, I don't know if it was in that documentary or what, but some interview or something, I guess on SkinWalker Ranch, this guy had a chainsaw. He was cutting up some wood or whatever. He just like set it down to go like grab a cup of water or something, came back, and then it was gone. He couldn't find it for a while. And then like an hour or two later, he's noticed it's up in a tree.
Yeah, that's
well, hey, I want to bring up one more thing, and then I gotta run, but I wanted to ask Ryan, now the remote viewing aspect of that container, I don't know if you're wanting to tell that part of the story, but what I also want to ask you was when we were out there, are you using your own remote viewing skills or contacting me to say, you know, we had this report of this object, or we had the report of these lights, or Erik took this picture? I mean, are you anybody remote viewing what might have been there that night? I'm curious.
I'm really glad that you brought this up, because I do have a file there in my filing cabinet, and I think I've shown Jeff some of the images by remote viewers around the world that were tasked by the people I had in charge of this. And no matter what you think of remote viewing, the consistency, how universally the same a lot of these sketches and images were and what they believed transpired was mind-blowing. And yeah, some of the vehicles that were drawn, if you want to call them vehicles or craft, they look more like drones, were like things out of science fiction novels. And, you know, for somebody to creatively come up with this thing on it on their own, and then somebody across the planet come up with the same thing, and then to have a multitude of those in a row, it's super unlikely. And especially given that they don't really know what location talking about. A lot of times these remote viewing targets are just a series of numbers, and the tasker give that to the best remote viewers for the purpose of finding out what happened. And they don't want to front load the remote view with any details about the case or location. And it's stunning. It is absolutely stunning. Yeah, some of those have come back very interesting. It makes me wonder what our military really has as far as toys and special projects and exotic technologies, because if these are not of our military, then there's something else utilizing wildly science fiction-y looking craft right under our noses. And I don't know which it is, because both are possible, but there's something going on.
Yeah, absolutely. And yeah, I actually got a, yeah, I think we were going to do 2 hours, but I actually kind of got to run too. So, and I guess Erik has to run too. So I guess we'll wrap it up here. Is there any last points you want to make real quick, or anything you want to get out there before we, any of you guys, before we get rolling?
Nothing I can think of off the top of my list. How about you, Jeff?
No, not really. I just, you know, since we're here right now, I just want to thank you, Ryan, for allowing me to be part of all of this. You know, I'm just very blessed that we've become friends and that you allow me to come to the property and experience this stuff and share with me the things that you share with me. I mean, it's just, it's unbelievable where my life has gone, for one, but just to be a part of this and to be able to experience this, and it's awesome. So I just want to thank you so much for that. And like Gigi was just saying, I can't wait to go back now just from this interview. So I'm going to probably be hitting you up so I can go back in a couple weeks.
Sounds good. Well, thank you so much, Gigi, for getting us together and chatting about this. It's something that really intrigues me and interests me, and I think the more people that are open-minded to it, we're going to find all kinds of things that are important to humanity, much like, you know, the government would not be looking into this if it was not important. They would not be documenting this in the past if it was not important, and they would not be trying to weaponize any of this unless it was important.
Absolutely.
Yeah, so true.
That says a lot in itself. And all right, so real quick, where can everybody find you guys? Ryan?
Yeah, you can find info about the area at spacewolfresearch.com. That's just the website for the property. I also have a little podcast, heroparanormal.com. And I've written a couple books on the subject matter. If you want to buy those, you can go to ryanpatrickburns.com.
All right, good deal. And Jeff, what about you?
You can find me at etalk.tv, typical place. Twitter as well, at etalk.tv. And don't let Ryan fool you. It's just not a small podcast. It's an amazing podcast. It gets great guests and always, always interesting.
Right on, right on. And Erik already took off, and JP had to get ready for his show. So that's it, ladies and gentlemen. Thanks for... That is not the right... But, ladies and gentlemen,
long show.
Yeah, thanks for tuning in here to the B-Sides and Rarities edition of Shift Happens. This show is hosted and produced by yours truly, Gigi. You can follow me on Twitter, Instagram, Facebook, all that stuff. All the links are over at shifthappensradio.com. And thanks to Jeff, Ryan, and Erik for coming on tonight. Co-host is JP. He had to boogie off to do his other show, which is about to come on in an hour over there on etalk.tv. Associate producer is Brad Harris, and as always, all blames and faults go to Fran. That's right, hashtag Fran's fault. Alright folks, thanks for tuning in. We'll see you next Friday on the Fringe FM for another episode of Shift Happens. Alright folks, have a great rest of your weekend, and we'll see you soon. Cheers.
Thank you.